So, I think it's time to start. If somebody is there with unmuted microphone, please mute your microphone. So, I did it already in advance, but sometimes it's not working. So please check yourself and please mute your microphone to avoid background noise. So, hello, everybody. My name is Michael Soll, and I'm working for Frontier Lab as European Business Development Manager to support both our customers and our business partners in Europe. So, before I start my presentation, some organizational remarks. So, we have more than 100 people registered, and so I'm more than happy about it. Furnace Pyrolyzer. Then I come to the introduction of our analytical method map. I talk about the new product, the new Polar Magic Chemisorber. Then we get to another chapter, failure analysis and identification of unknown material. And finally, I will introduce the detection of microplastic using our new identification algorithm. So, Frontier Lab was founded in 1991 by Dr. Chuichi Watanabe, also called Chu-san. So, with the support of polymer scientists at Nagoya University in Japan, he developed a pyrolyzer based on a vertical microfurnace design. So we will discuss the characteristics of the microfurnace design shortly. We are the global manufacturer, and our main products are a series of pyrolyzers, such as the multi-shot and single-shot pyrolyzer, rapid screening reactors for catalyst analysis, and a line of ultra-alloy stainless steel capillary columns. Our European office is located in Germany, in Essen, so a state North Rhine-Westphalia. So, let's discuss how you can expand the material characterization capabilities using pyrolysis GCMS. Substances at ambient temperature exist as gas, liquid, or solid, mostly depending on their molecular weight. Materials that are soluble in solvents can be analyzed by GC or LC. Of these materials, about 30% can be analyzed by GC, including derivatization, and about 85% by LC, including some polymers with the proper solvents. But there are also some insoluble materials that cannot be analyzed using LC, LCMS, GC, or GCMS. However, these insoluble materials can be analyzed by pyrolysis GCMS. There is no need for any solvent extraction or sample pretreatment, as a solid sample can be analyzed as is. So, using pyrolysis GCMS, the entire range of organic materials from gases to solids can be analyzed, and that's how PyGCMS can expand your capabilities of GCMS analysis. So, coming to some fundamentals, typically polymers can go through three main degradation mechanisms: in heat, of course, and under inert atmosphere. Depending on the mixture, the polymer might go through one or a combination of these categories, and you see these categories here. That is random scission, the depolymerization, and you see as example polystyrene here breaking into the monomeric units, or you can also have side group elimination. Our customers have many different analytical challenges, so they are dealing with different analytes, what are listed here. So that can be synthetic polymers like plastics, textile, microplastic, can be paints, inks or lacquers. We are also dealing with natural polymers such as lignin, paper, silk. We also have customers analyzing coal or tobacco smoke. And then many customers are also interested to see the additives and to analyze them, like antioxidants, stabilizers, phthalates, flame retardants, and so on. And we also have customers in geochemistry. They check soil and the organic matter. To support all our customers as good as possible, we have created for many years a nice and comprehensive database with currently over 220 technical notes. And and these are free to download as PDF files. This database is growing continuously. I can only recommend to visit our website from time to time and search documents what are interesting for your work. This database is, of course, searchable. So before I talk about actual instrumentation applications, please let me do a sidestep and highlight the end of the support and consumables of our former Pyrolyzer 2020 series, what are still used at some customers since many years. However, I have to say that now it's time to change to our new 3030D Pyrolyzer, and this is true for both models, for the 2020D and 2020S single shot pyrolyzer, because all the consumables and parts will no longer be available after December 30th, and that's is the reason why you really should consider to upgrade your pyrolyzer if not already done. So what's new versus the predecessor? So we have an improved precision, accuracy and range. We are working with a new ceramic heater. We have expanded the temperature range. It's now going up to 1050 degrees Celsius. We have a higher interface temperature maximum. We could enhance our productivity. We have faster cooling and also faster ramp rates. And this 3030D has was redesigned also for easier maintenance, performance and ruggedness. And also important, the pyrolyzer come with 2 years of factory warranty. So the comparison of the technical specs is shown here, but I want to go into details now. Basically, and that is the main message here, all specification data are better than before. And of course, what you have expected anyway, I would say. Currently, there are three different types of pyrolyzer technologies available. The filament type of pyrolyzer, what working with a coiled wire and transfer lines. The Curie point pyrolyzer, what are using ferromagnetic foils, and the vertical furnace, microfurnace pyrolyzer using a low mass ceramic heater and so-called foil-free mechanism. One additional remark here, the Curie point pyrolyzer are disappearing more and more. Reasons are the missing temperature capabilities and the very inconvenient handling. Both filament type pyrolyzer and Curie point pyrolyzer have a preheating step before pyrolysis, what could lead to loss of information. So how does the FrontierLab furnace technology look like and work? So you easily put your sample in the sample cup over here, shown in yellow. The sample cup is kept in the beginning at ambient temperature. So you heat up the furnace to the desired pyrolysis temperature. Then you release the sample cup. You see the nice animation. And it falls free into the heated zone. Then the pyrolysates go this way here. They will be directly swept onto the GC analytical column for separation and detection by MS or any other detectors. The benefits and advantages of this technology are, so we are not using any transfer line. We have no evaporation, degradation or thermosetting before the analysis. We are working with a one-step analysis, it's continuous. And we have the full range of thermal profiling and we have a high reproducibility and accuracy of the temperature with 0.1 degrees Celsius. Using the FrontierLab microfurnace pyrolyzer, you can really do a full mass range analysis. If you pyrolyze, in this example, polyethylene at 600 degrees Celsius, shown here, you can even detect very high boiling and polar compounds as well as light compounds. This is a single step process as mentioned before, and we are not using any switching valves, no trap, no transfer line, and no preheating where volatile compounds can get lost already. So the filament technology is described here in more detail. The sample is subject to thermal exposure prior to heating and evaporation, shown here. Therefore, denaturation, degradation, and thermosetting could occur. So this is a two-step, non-continuous process with a high risk to lose information about your sample. So in summary, what can you expect? Why can you expect better results with FrontierLab microfurnace pyrolyzer compared to filament type of pyrolyzer? The summary, again. So we have direct connection to the GC. We place the pyrolyzites directly on column. We have no degradation before analysis, so we see the full range of compounds, volatiles, additives, heavy polar, and the polymers. We do not have any cross-contamination active sites. Everything is also, every hot parts are coated, also quartz coated, and we have a precise and reproducible data since we are measuring, we have a readout of the set temperature always. So sample preparation. So the good thing normally if you work with our pyrolyzer is that you almost don't need any sample preparation. So depending on the type of the of your sample, you can use any tool like knife or polymer prepper, or if you have liquids, you can use a microsyringe, or we also have available for you micro puncher for thin folds. And then you place the sample directly into the sample cup, no need for solvent extraction, and you are ready for analysis. So then we have developed a series of techniques referred to as the method map to chemically characterize samples using the multimode pyrolyzer. These techniques are applicable to virtually any organic compounds from volatiles to high molecular weight polymers. The first step is the evolved gas analysis, which provides a clear picture of the thermal profile of the sample. EGA is then used to determine the next step and guides you what to do next. It will show if a TD-only step is needed or if multiple hard-cutting steps are needed. And the EGA also shows the optimal temperature that is needed for flash pyrolysis. I come to this now. So we always recommend to run an EGAMS first, as first step of the method map, especially if you want to analyze unknown materials. So what are you doing here? So you see the setup over here. You place the sample into the pyrolyzer at low temperature, and then you ramp up the temperature over time at a certain speed. Here, you don't use any separation column. It's just a short deactivated connection here going to the MS detector. And the GC oven is set to isothermal. And then you get this so-called thermogram, the thermal profile of your sample. So And these compounds evolve continuously from a sample as the temperature increases, and that is the plot of the response versus the furnace temperature here. So based on your EGMS result, you may select the best technique to answer your analytical questions. And this could be different. So maybe you only need the thermal desorption, so thermal extraction of additives and volatiles, or you perform a true flash pyrolysis, we call it also single shot GCMS for polymers, or you can combine methods, we call it double shot analysis, so a thermal desorption followed by flash pyrolysis on one sample, or you can even perform hard cutting, so it's thermally slicing, e.g. a thermogram, to deformulate or for deformulation, reverse engineering, failure analysis, and so on. Or last but not least, you can even perform so-called reactive pyrolysis using a derivatization agent like TMMH, for example. In the end, you get this kind of results depending on the method you have used. So this slide is showing again the EGAMS setup and the resulting EGA thermogram here. So you can read out the optimal pyrolysis temperature here from the thermogram, since no more compounds are evolving beyond 600 degrees Celsius at this example. If you then perform a single shot pyrolysis, you get out mixed information both from additives and polymers, and like shown here. Data interpretation, so peak identification, could be difficult because you have could have a very busy chromatogram. Therefore, double shot analysis will help here. How does it look like? So when you are using double shot analysis, you perform as first step a TD GCMS run. So you can refer to the EGA MS result and the related temperature zone to define the best temperature for the TD step. Of course, you need to install a separation color on this for this. An optional vent-free adapter would avoid venting the MS, shown here as an option. And the cryotrap MJT working with liquid nitrogen could be used for focusing of volatile compounds. This is the first shot and you get the TD GCMS result. Afterwards, you run a pyrolysis step at 600 degrees Celsius, for example, to obtain the pyrogram, and you get information on polymeric compound and finally to identify the polymer. So, using our optional autosampler AutoShot AS1020E, you are able to run all these methods also in combination automatically. Here I have prepared a little animation for you to illustrate the double shot automation as an example. I will start the video now and hope it will work. Click. Okay. First sample introduction. The sample is falling down to a kind of waiting position. Then the system will be purged by helium to get rid of the air. Then the sample cup drops into the heated pyrolyzer, and then you start a thermal desorption. This is the first step, as mentioned. And the evolved gases are introduced to the GC column for analysis. Then the sample cup is recovered to standby position for the next step. And you see the moving control pin. And for flash pyrolysis, of course, it is heated to the desired pyrolysis temperature. And the pyrolysates are introduced to the GC column for analysis. And then finally, the sample cup will be recovered by a pressure pulse, and then with a nice salto falling into the sample cup recovery chute. So I hope you like this small video And if you want it, I can send it to you. So, now hard cutting. So for more complex materials and to obtain comprehensive information about it, you can do hard cutting GCMS, what is basically a sequential thermal slicing of the EGA MS. In this example, we start 5 different TD GCMS runs to get very detailed information about the compounds in each thermal zone. To support the hard cut, we offer a so-called selective sampler, what is basically a flow switching device. So if a certain fraction of the EGA MS should be analyzed, you select sampling on here. So this can be done using our control software, and a sample is reaching the separation column as usual. So if you don't want to have this fraction to reach the column, this is this setting here. The selective sampler is set to sampling off, and the sample will be purged out due to the pressure difference, and the GC won't get started because you open this valve here and the samples will be purged out. And of course, all this can be done automatically using the auto sampler. So now let's talk about how we can identify additives in polymers. For this, we provide our patented software F-Search. So F-Search is a search engine with 4 unique libraries for identifying additives, volatiles, lighter components, as well as oligomers or heavier and polymeric materials. So the actual version 3.6 has some 1,000 polymers stored and about 500 additives. The F-Search also allows you to create your own user library to perform contamination analysis, comparison analysis, and failure analysis. F-Search also has other features like the ability to overlay different chromatograms, extract different M over Z ions, and integrated sum analysis where the engine can integrate the whole chromatogram, make an average mass spectrum, and identify the corresponding polymer. So this book, what still exists and what can be purchased, for example, at Amazon at about 250 euro, is used along with F-Search and MS libraries as a reference. So the book has pyrograms, EGA thermograms, and MS data of the major pyrolysates for many polymers. I think it's we have 165 polymers here. It also has some detailed information about the peak assignment tables and EGA thermograms for each polymer. So, and if you look inside, the page can look like this. So one example here, polyethylene from the book. And you see the sample number here, the pyrogram at 600 degrees Celsius, the peak assignment table together with molecular weight, retention time index, and the intensity. Then the EGA thermogram, the average mass spectrum of the EGA thermogram, and then the mass spectrum of the top major peaks. So now we have so far explained mainly about the multifunctional pyrolyzer. So in order to use this device more conveniently and efficiently, we also have a large selection of peripheral equipment and products. I just want to highlight a few what I did not mention before. So, for example, we have the carrier gas selector. It's a device for easy switching of carrier gases in case of operating pyrolysis in air atmosphere, for example. Then we have the microjet cryotrap. This is a device to firmly trap the thermally desorbed components and improve the peak shape of low boiling compounds. And then we have here, schematically, our micro UV irradiator. This is a quite sophisticated accessory for accelerated UV degradation studies. And last but not least, we have also a series of ultra-alloy metal capillary columns. And always, if you purchase our pyrolyzer, one 30-meter 5ms separation phase column is in the package as well as an EGA tube. Now, after explaining fundamentals and methods, I'd like to introduce our new product, or one of our new products, the Polar Magic Chemisorber. Actually, this is a product beyond pyrolysis and beyond typical non-volatile compounds and polymers. Since a couple of years, Frontier Lab is offering a non-polar magic chemisorber. Here, a thick PDMS, a layer have with high affinity towards non-polar compounds is bounded to a titanium tube. We have different versions concerning dimensions and film thicknesses available, listed here. The new polar magic chemisorber is coated with polyethylene glycol for high selectivity towards polar compounds. So both magic chemisorber types are reusable. So how do you sample using our chemisorbers? So basically you have three options. So you can do direct immersion shown here, or you can do a headspace sampling, or you do gas sampling using this kind of devices over here. Come to the first application here. So the first application is the analysis of air inside a new car, so the famous new car smell, which we all like. And after gas sampling, the extraction element is placed inside the sample cup and the thermal resorption GCMS analysis is performed. So and you can see the results here in this chromatogram. We have marked the different chemical classes with colors, and you see selectivity of the magic pack chemisorber since polar carboxylic acids, alcohols, aldehydes and phenols have been extracted and thermoresorbed. And this is one of our technical notes you can download from our database. And then this slide now shows a direct selectivity comparison of a polar and non-polar chemisorber when red wine is used and analyzed. Sampling is done by direct immersion, and you can see in this table here, to the right side, all compounds in red color and marked here with a red number are only extracted by the new polar chemisorber, showing the different selectivities of both magic chemisorbers. So that is another application note what we have available, ready for distribution. And we have many other applications for the new and also for the PDMS magic chemisorbers available. Just ask me if you are interested. Now, we do a clear cut and discuss an important application area for our analytical pyrolyzer. It's a failure or damage analysis. In this case, our customer observed a significantly shorter lifetime of a rubber pump diaphragm. And so the good part was working for more than 1,200 hours. So in both cases it's black rubber, and the bad material or the back pump only worked less than 800 hours. So the questions have been, what rubber is used and what difference do we see between the two samples? And you see the picture of the samples over here, so tiny pieces here, and you see the sampling position here, and you see also the cracks in the samples. So I already explained, please start first with EGA. So and first, according to our method map, we start also in this case with EGAMS. So EGAs, especially the low temperature area between good and bad, are different. So in this area here. However, the triplicates, because we did a triplicate run of the same sample, give very reproducible results. But you see also here, the peak at 335 degrees Celsius is here completely missing at the bad sample. And you also see here a small shift of the peak apex temperature between the good and the bad sample. So let's go into more detail now. So these are the pyrograms, single shot pyrograms of the good and the bad rubber. So the orange rectangle indicates the difference between the samples, good and bad, and duplicates. Again, very good reproducibility. So you can already sense some minor differences in the ticks. And the overlay chromatogram is in the next page, and then you can see in more detail the differences. So here, first, the bad material has obviously more hydrocarbons, so the hump on the chromatogram over here. And the good has several extra peaks at retention time 8 to 10 minutes and 13 to 15 minutes here. And these extra peaks are missing in the bad sample. So for identification, of course, you can need the NIST library, the NIST search. And these are the extra peaks of the good sample, peak 1 and 2. Peak 1 is identified as this cyclohexane derivate. But we don't know yet what polymer is related to this compound. And the peak 2 is a common fatty acid. So now we use F-search to identify the peak 1 using the pyrolysate lib, so the fragment library, and the additive library. So both are individual peak information libraries. You see the MS spectrum of the sample and the reference below. So, and we got the confirmation of the peak assignment, and we also get the information that the substance is originating at good match quality from chloroprene. Maybe you are aware about neoprene, that's a brand name. And we got strong evidence that the good sample has chloroprene rubber, whereas the bad sample has is missing this compound. Also, you can always switch here by clicking the result window in F-search between MS, like shown here, and chromatogram or thermogram window, just to verify your result again. Now let us get back to the EGMS and perform a thermal slicing of the EGA zones. Also, and we define this three different zones, B, D, and F, and perform consequently three different TDG-CMS runs. So in the hard-cut chromatograms shown here, there are some differences. If you look here and here, so, and we have this peaks A to F, and the zone F TDG-CMS here, 460 to 500 degrees Celsius, looks very similar for good and the bad samples. Obviously, the main polymer seems to be identical in both cases. So what about this peaks A to F now? So, and the peak A to F have been identified using F-search. And the table here is showing the result for each of the zones and compounds. In this case, we have found two different plasticizer, DHP and DOIP, an accelerator, and also fatty acids. So to identify the main polymer of the good and the bad rubber, we use F-search again. Now we switch to the pyrogram, the polymer library, and load the hardcut chromatogram of zone F. And we found in the result window EPDM in both cases to be the main polymer. As mentioned before, you can always switch back and forth between MS spectrum view and chromatogram thermogram view. Now this table is summarizing our findings and difference between the good and the bad sample. Obviously, the reason for the shorter lifetime of the bad material is the missing chloropane and also some additives. So with this information, we could get back to the customer and he got back to production and he could solve this issue. Now, I come to my final part and talk about a new identification algorithm for microplastics. Sorry. The software is still in development to become a real product, and I will only talk about the identification process. And of course, we also work on the quantification part. So, due to the global contamination of our environment with plastic, we need to monitor the pollution and especially the marine pollution to discover the unknown fate of the microplastic, what affects the marine food chain and life, and potentially also the human health. This pie diagram is showing the global plastic production ratio, and you see the main contributors like polypropylene over here, polyethylene, PVC, or polystyrene, etc. So we need to have a method to identify and quantify all these waste microplastic in various kinds of environmental matrices. So in 2017, Barbara Scholz-Böttcher and her group at the ICBM of the University Oldenburg has published this groundbreaking scientific report to identify and quantify simultaneously microplastic and environmental samples by pyrolysis GCMS. And this was the start of a series of papers and posters from her group. And very recently, she and her group also reported on microplastic found in table salt fleur de sel. So, what are the available and frequently used analytical methods for microplastic identification? So, particle-dependent spectroscopic methods and thermal methods are complementary and provide different information. Spectroscopic methods provide characteristic spectra and are in most cases non-destructive. Thermal methods give characteristic decomposition products and are destructive. I will focus on pyrolysis GCMS with a short comparison to TET GCMS compared to pyrolysis GCMS. Well, this is, of course, our opinion on that. So, we have a very high proven sensitivity. So, the limit of quantification is found to be smaller than 1 microgram absolute per polymer. So, what about TET-GCMS? So, the TET-GCMS people are claiming to detect microplastic in environmental samples without any pre-concentration or other sample preparation. However, to do this, the sample must contain more than, I think, 0.4 weight percent. And of course, this is very likely, unlikely, too high in a typical environmental sample. Therefore, sample preparation is getting, again, mandatory. So please be aware what they are talking about. So we have an enhanced sensitivity with thermochemolysis. So we can say we have an adaptable sensitivity if we look at PET or polycarbonate. Then we can use TMAH for derivatization. I come to that later. We don't have a risk of segregation, so because we have a direct online coupling versus TET GCMS is an offline coupling. So virtually all polymers, including PVC and polycarbonate, are possible, and TET GCMS is somehow limited here. So the microplastic identification quantification software tool as a product is in preparation, and we are aiming to have a kind of 30 seconds ID tool available. So, of course, we can also identify additives in microplastic. Our analysis is quite fast. So about 30 minutes versus about more than 2 hours if we talk about TET GCMS. So we have a proven instrument since decades and also a high applicability beyond microplastic. So it's not limited to microplastic like TET GCMS. It's quite cost efficient because the system configuration is adaptable. We have shown various accessories. We also have a high installed microplastic user base already in Europe and growing. And also our system is GCMS vendor independent. And Frontier Lab, needless to say, we have a very high expertise in polymer analysis using pyrolysis GCMS. And I'm looking for a new slogan. I can say we are the pyrolyzer people, or we like it hot. I don't know what you like. So preparation of elemental sample, just one slide about it. So the big challenge here that you have a very high particle range and a very small microplastic content versus a high organic and inorganic matrix load. So therefore, we need to consider a proper sample preparation and a pre-concentration sequence what is not affecting the different polymer types. So you may refer to the already mentioned publications to find details about sample preparation, but I cannot go into detail now. So the next slide, this slide is now referring to the next slides, are now referring to this very recent publication shown here, what we have done in collaboration with Marco Mattonai from the University of Pisa, with the title Identification Algorithm for Polymer Mixtures Based on PyGCMS and its application for microplastic analysis in environmental samples. So for the microplastic, we use a special system setup like shown here. So to prevent peak shape distortion and to prove reproducibility, the glass liner in the injector, shown here, was packed with quartz wool and deactivated packing material with GC stationary phase. Also, a backflash system was also used for microplastic analysis to reduce the analysis time when dealing with pyrolysis products with high boiling points, such as long chain hydrocarbon obtained from the pyrolysis of polyethylene and polypropylene, for example. And Frontier Lab intends to offer a complete microplastic package in the future. So these accessories are add-ons. This means you can improve and modify your system also step by step later and start with, let's say, normal or basic setup first, but also works for microplastic, of course. So this is a flowchart of the algorithm for polymer mixture identification. It's taken from the publication mentioned before. The left column refers to the steps for the generation of the reference, a summated mass spectra library, while the right column here refers to the processing of the result obtained from an unknown sample. It is crucial to find the most specific pyrolysis products, what should have in best case also a very high abundance to provide good sensitivity, what is really not always easy. Also, the retention time indices search window must be defined. So to ensure compatibility with other system parameters, we have programmed and integrated a retention time index generator in our software. Now the two final steps are the calculation of similarity between the two summated mass spectra and finally the report. So the microplastic search algorithm is shown here using polypropylene as example. You see from the top to the bottom, the tick of the reference mixture. They extracted ion chromatins of relevant masses, so in this case four different M over Z, and the referring mass spectra, and finally the tick of the polypropylene standard. The summated mass spectra of the four extracted ions is generated and compared to the summated mass spectrum of the polypropylene standard. And the similarity in this case has been 98.4%, just to show how the algorithm is working in principle. So in here, you can see an overview of all the summated mass spectra of the 11 polymers, and all the assigned values are used for the similarity calculations here, or the numbers here. And this table is listing again the polymers, the pyrolysates, or the polymers, the pyrolysate, their retention time indices, and the M over Z values as taken from the publication. And the compounds with an asterisk are those used to calculate the signal to noise ratio by extracting the M over Z profiles of the signal. So, since I already talked recently about PET and polycarbonate, TMAH can be used as derivatization agent for microplastic detection. Sorry. And this was also reported by Scholz-Böttcher et al. Recently. So, two nice effects of the TMAH derivatization are that the resulting chromatogram is simplified and basically only one big peak one big peak, of course, can be seen, ensuring high sensitivity for PET and for polycarbonate. So this derivatization is also improving sensitivity for polyurethane for same reasons. Now, this table is taken again from the publication and is summarizing a result for the various mixtures of the 11 polymers concerning the match quality, M percent, and signal to noise ratio. And the yellow marked findings are considered to be false positive in this case. In this case, the threshold to get a hit has been set to 80% for match quality, and signal to noise must be bigger than 3. Therefore, sensitivity was perfect at 100% in this example, and specificity was about 84%. Now, this table is basically showing the same data, but using a different layout. And again, 11 polymers are mixed in various combinations and analyzed. And the positive findings are again, or this time, marked in red color. And here you see the second part of the table. If we set the match quality threshold to bigger than 85 and signal to noise threshold to more than or about 50, we can reach 100% both for sensitivity and specificity. Concerning quantification algorithm, I fear I'm not able to say much about it today. We are working on it, and it will be a very difficult task when you have environmental matrices. So we check different parameters in the moment, also the mathematics, the quantifier ions, and also derivatizations. So this is all what I can, or what I am allowed to say today. So this slide is now finally showing the proof of principle again in the pyrogram of a real marine microplastic sample here in red, in comparison to our reference sample in green over here. So sampling was done by a dragnet, and they found microplastic particles have been mixed and milled. And the result is that we found, in this case, four different types of polymers: polypropylene, PET, PET, polycarbonate, and polyethylene. And here you see an additional peak. This is our internal standard deuterated anthracene. So, come to summary and conclusion briefly. So I hope I could show you that the micro furnace paralyzer are superior to other filament or curly point type of technologies. And the PyGCMS and related thermal methods are powerful approaches for failure analysis and to deformulate polymeric materials. I have introduced the magic chemisorbers, what are polarity selective extraction elements beyond paralysis and for thermal desorption GCMS. Please always refer to our method map as guideline and workflow. And F-search and the new microplastic identification algorithms are very useful tools to identify polymeric components and additives even in complex mixtures, as well as microplastic in environmental samples. So I would say I'm the end of my presentation. I thank you very much for your intention, and now I stop sharing my screen and to take your questions if you have any, and then you can type in the questions in the chat window and I will try to answer the questions.